to the Sanctuary Fellowship's YouTube channel. We hope you enjoy the message you're about to receive. Be blessed and enjoy.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm very, very privileged. And first of all, let me thank my wife for taking over announcements for me this week. That wasn't some random 15-year-old. That was a grown woman who looks very young with three kids. You know what's funny is that when we finished filming that, she was like, if I continue doing it, I think I'll get better at it. And I was like, wait, just one time. Taking advantage, I tell you. So thank you to my wife. She's gangster that way. So as I was about to say, it's a privilege to be addressing this congregation first and on the first Sunday of the new year. Amen. Today, I'm normally kind of jokey, and maybe it's because I get nervous and I joke a lot, but today I've come on a mission. God has been wrecking me prophetically in the last couple of weeks in preparation for today, and I believe that I have a very strong prophetic message that isn't mind-blowing, but it's simply directional for this congregation and for the leadership of this house. So, but before we get started, as Minister Lee mentioned, those of you who were not here with us on New Year's Eve, right? Who was here? Show of hands. A lot of you. Great. On New Year's Eve, we showed this video, which kind of captured 2019. And since some of you weren't here, we want to show you this video now, right? I think the team has it all queued up. And it's basically like the top five moments of 2019. It's kind of dope. And you don't realize what God did until you look back and you go, oh, snap. So I want you to see this video before we get started. FYI, it's about 15 minutes. So settle in. It's not going to be a 1.5-minute video. Settle in. Watch it. When we're done, I'm going to come back up and preach for 39 hours. So you might want to call out of work tomorrow. Okay, so enjoy this video. It's the top five moments of 2019.
Hello, I'm Jay Cruz, and welcome to the Sanctuary Fellowship. Normally, I'm the announcements guy, but this time we have a very special video for you. As 2019 comes to an end, we realize something. It's not just the end of a year, it's the end of a decade. But this year is probably one of the most memorable years of TSF's history. 2019 showed itself to be an amazing year for the growth of our church. And we're not talking about in numbers, we're talking about in our people. We saw ministries be launched, ministries be relaunched. We see more healthy people walking around in our congregation than ever before. It's an amazing thing to see. Now, since there were a lot of memorable moments this year, it was not easy coming up with a list of top moments for the year. But without further ado, here are the TSF top five moments of 2019. Sitting in at number five, the full story. If you're a member of TSF, then you know that our senior pastor, Pastor George Martinez, isn't just a great preacher, but he's also really great at his spoken words. On February 10th, Pastor George was wrapping up a series on the Old Testament, and he combined the entire series in one spoken word. It was amazing. So for your number five moment, here's Pastor George Martinez with his spoken word, the full story.
Creation. From the beginning, you established it. You said, let there be light, and it was right. Opened my eyes, gave me sight, pulled the helpmate from my side, and it was all right as you intended it. Evil came forth and confused it. He said, we could be like gods, and we believed it. With one bite, our eyes were opened, and we lost our sight. Naked and uncovered, now you see the real me. Cover it up with a fig tree, religion, sacrifice. You cover me, I'm forgiven. Every book after that repeats the same theme. Tells the same story, man competing with God for his glory, surrender. Can you not see how long must he contend? God is not your enemy, he's your friend. Where can I go to hide from your love? No, you're before me and behind me with your hand just above. No matter where I turn my face, there's your grace. You're reckless. You put on flesh to have us reject it. You set the price for our redemption and then paid it. Gave us your righteousness and told us to wear it. Your mercy. Even at our worst in the days of Noah, you let us start over. Father, forgive me. Create a pure heart in me. Teach me to number my days, to walk in your ways, to live holy. Even when you're silent, teach me to wait on your glory. From here to there, make me a part of your story. I'll follow.
Sitting in at number 4, guest speaker prophesied. On October 20th, we had guest speaker Pastor Jasmine Georges. She delivered a powerful message and went on to prophesy over our entire congregation. We believe that the message and the prophetic word that was delivered through Pastor Jasmine was not only a word for 2019, but a true glimpse into the future of 2020. So for your number 4 moment, here's guest speaker Pastor Jasmine Georges delivering her prophetic word.
This has never happened to me before. When I preach in a church, that to just know that God is pleased. It's going to be like David's mighty men coming out of this house. In the natural, people that appear to be like rejects shook the nation of Israel. God is about to do miracles and signs and wonders, not only in healing, but just in lives. We're gonna worship God. I'm gonna walk and I'm gonna lay hands on people, and we're gonna let God do what God does best, amen? Which is to let the Spirit flow.
Sitting in at number 3, church launching freestyle. October 13th was a historical day for the Sanctuary Fellowship. Our senior pastors, Pastor George and Michelle, officially launched TSF Español, which officially released Pastor Bert and Alice Boca Chica. They were and still will always be tremendous pillars in this house, and though we were sad to see them go, we're so happy that God is using them in this level. One thing that Pastor Bert Boca Chica was always known for was his skills on the mic, and he did not disappoint on his final attempt. Pastor Bert left us with one last freestyle before his departure. So your number 3 moment is brought to you by Pastor Bert Boca Chica delivering his church launching freestyle.
I had to grab this mic at least one more time. I couldn't leave this place without one more rhyme.
Oh no. Yeah.
I don't know how this is going to work out, but just wait. I didn't join a gym, I joined him. What I lift up God is going great. Every morning when we wake up, we have souls in mind. And I just pray that that continues to happen every single time. With every single person that's sitting in this place, when you seek his face and pray for his grace, sit patiently and wait for that to take place. Sometimes we rush, we want to jump up the steps, but we got to understand that we have to do what's left in our heart that God has placed there. Because in each and every one of us, we all have some kind of cares. We have to care for his word. We got to care for his people. You got to care for this church. Old school people call it steeple. When God is in this place, there's no denying it's going to be fresh. Nothing rhymes with that. I just had to say that. No, seriously, I'm not going to say nothing else, but thank you very much. This is a tough task that we have ahead of us, but we know that God has called us for this. You know, yes, es santuario español, but we care for all people. It's not just Spanish people. It has nothing to do with that. This is what God has called us for, and we're stepping out in faith, and we're trusting that God is going to place in front of us the people that we need to minister to. And just continue to pray that God will continue to give us the words in Spanish to minister to the, you know, to the people that are in front of us. Again, thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Sitting in at number 2, Men March for Breakthrough. On November 17th, our very own Pastor Michelle Martinez challenged the men of this house to stand up and march around the church 7 times in representation of the walls of Jericho. This was a pivotal and symbolic moment. The men of our house not only stood up, but they stood proud and they worshiped around the entire congregation. It was a beautiful moment to see the men marching around the church, worshiping and singing wholeheartedly. You could literally see the walls breaking down at every moment. It was beautiful. So your number 2 moment is brought to you by the men of the house, Iron Sharpens Iron, as they marched around our church to break down the spiritual walls of Jericho.
And I kept getting the word today, wall, wall, wall. And everything we sang today was about the wall. And what Pastor preached today was about the walls. But I feel like we built these walls and they're as thick as those walls of Jericho. And I speak for myself, right? Because when you've been hurt, when you've been damaged, we build these walls because sometimes we feel like we can't survive. But God wants to tell you today that those walls have to come down. I know this is going to sound weird, but the people of Jericho, they walk. God told them, worship around the wall one time every day for 6 days. The 7th day, you're going to walk around it 7 times. And at the end, you're going to shout. They shouted, those walls came down. those walls came down and they claimed their victory. They claimed their promise. They claimed what God had given them. Pastor E is going to lead you, and I want you men, women, I want you to shout in praise, but I want the men of this house, I want you to follow Pastor E, and I want you to walk around 7 times, and we're going to shout.
What the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Now, as I said before, 2019 was an extremely amazing year, so it was very difficult to narrow it down to just 5 top moments, and it was even more of a challenge to pick the very best moment of the year. But I think that we'll all agree on this one, sitting in at number 1, baptism miracles. On September 29th, TSF held a baptism service. This was going to be just like any normal baptism service. We made a call, we asked people to sign up, we got them ready for baptism. But towards the very end of the service, Pastor Gary Fishman went up and made a challenge to our congregation, as he strongly believed in his spirit that there were people there who wanted to be baptized, and he opened up our service to anyone who wanted to be baptized at that very moment. Now, I must say, our team was actually prepared for this moment. We had extra clothes, we had towels, but what we were not prepared for was that people didn't want the extra clothes. People literally went from their seats directly into the water. People went in fully clothed. Personally, it was one of the most beautiful things that I've ever witnessed in a church setting. I could not believe what I was seeing. People that we didn't even know, first time in our church, going up on that stage and being baptized. So TSF proudly presents to you the number one moment of 2019, our baptism service.
Amen. I'm just going to ask for your attention for one more minute, because what you saw happening today is the power of lives changed by Jesus Christ. That's why we have the waters of baptism. It's a symbol that every sin, every regret has been washed away by the blood of Jesus. The baptismal tank is a picture going under the water. It means that the person I used to be is gone. God wants to do something special. He wants to give us eternal life by taking our spirits inside and making them alive, alive, full of fire and passion for Him. I'm believing that there's at least one person here tonight, and you're saying, just like these that I just witnessed, I want to change life. I'm tired of the way that I'm living. I want to be changed. I want to be transformed. I want the joy that I saw that those had coming out of the tank. It's available tonight for every one of you. It doesn't matter what you've done. I could go into a prison on Murderer's Row and I could speak the same message. See, today in the modern church, we wait, we do applications, we have classes. That's not how they did it in the Bible times. Back in the book of Acts in the Bible, they said, somebody raise their hand, I want Jesus right into the tank. We got extra clothes, we got towels, we got shorts. I believe there's someone here that you want to get baptized right now. I'm going to ask you to just stand up and come forward. Thank you.
that was your TSF Top 5 Moments of 2019. Hope you've enjoyed this video and the year 2019. Now, those moments were amazing, but we don't believe God is done yet. 2020 is going to be an even better year. We're believing in miracles, signs, and wonders. And we're so happy that we get to share these moments with you. So we thank you from the bottom of our hearts, and we thank our Lord and Savior for giving us a beautiful 2019. We cannot wait to see what God does for 2020. Thanks again for watching, and have a blessed and happy new year. I was breathing, but
not alive. That's a good looking guy. If you would just rise with me for 1 second, we're just going to pray, and I want to read some scripture to you. We're going to get started. We're going to rush into this because that was a long video, but it was awesome. You must, before we even get started, you must ask yourself, why did I decide to show this video again? And it's because it's difficult to understand what God is going to do in 2020 when you don't rejoice in what God did in 2019, right? And I'm going to say this because I almost feel this prophetically to say that maybe somebody needs to hear this right now. So 2019 may have been difficult for you. And sometimes you have to look at the beautiful things that happened. I think some of the reasons people entered into that water, for example, in the baptism was because they were broken and they needed something new and they were tired. Like Pastor Gary was saying in that video, I just need a refreshing. And then boom, they came out. Life wasn't less difficult the next day. Bills were still there. Job still was terrible maybe, right? Situations weren't great maybe, but you went in there and you said, I'm making a decision. Those are beautiful moments in 2019, amen? Let's bow our heads. I want you to listen to this scripture I'm about to read to you. This is Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 and 8. And it says this, keep on asking and you will receive what you ask for. Keep on seeking and you will find. Keep on knocking and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives. Everyone who seeks finds, and everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity to come before you once again. Lord, silence our agenda right now, Father God. Remove the thoughts that don't belong to you at this very moment. Focus us, Lord, on your word, Lord Jesus. Destroy my notes, Father God, and you take over right now in the name of Jesus. Speak to us. Use us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to go through this fast. Don't worry. I'm not going to keep you here 39 hours. 38 and a half. Amen. So like I said before, I'm very grateful to address you guys the first Sunday of the new year. But I'm very grateful for this church. I don't know if you guys feel that there's this, something's going on. There's a rumbling in this congregation. And I'm grateful for the members of the church too. You know, whether you guys know this or not, I've been here for a very long time. My very first service, I was invited to the very first service of TSF. I couldn't make it because I was away. I came to the second service. So I've been here since service number 2. All right, what, 14 years? 14 years, right? I was only one. That's weird. So 14 years ago, came here. I've been here for that long. I don't think I've ever seen a year like 2019 in this church. There's been a lot of great moments, and we're not talking about big moments. We're not talking about finance. We're talking about the way there's this movement happening. Put it this way. There have been maybe 5 or 6 families who have done pretty much everything for like 14 years straight, right? You see the same people coming in, and we tried doing everything, running every single ministry. All these things that you see now, we tried it, and we had this vision for it, but we kept running ourselves dry, right? You guys remember when the tree fell? That was a tough season for us, and we needed that. We needed that. That was like a breaking moment, literally. It broke through the ceiling, but that was a breaking moment, especially for the leadership, where we said, we can't do this on our own. And then we came back in here and Pastor George said, we're not going to do that anymore. We're not going to run ourselves dry and we're going to figure this out. And then we started, like, you know, when you do that, you're forced to have to make decisions and you have to stop certain things. And it wasn't that certain things weren't as important. It wasn't like ministries that were on at that moment weren't important, but we had to say, I can't do everything though, right? And then all of a sudden, the congregation that we were investing in and pouring into started seeing the need. And no one asked you guys. You guys just started stepping up. And all these ministries are more vibrant than they ever were before, or just as vibrant. I'm telling you, you never saw a dip in the children's ministry going from Pastor Mo to Jillian. We never saw so many ministries like the care ministry and like the reach out, vibrant. It's because of what God is doing in you guys. And I'm super honored. And I would say give yourselves a round of applause because I'm super honored to be in front of you guys, man. But now I ask you, what does God have for us in 2020? Loaded question. I think it's loaded for me because 2019, though it was an amazing year, it was a very difficult year for me personally. And it wasn't because I was, you know, sometimes when you say difficult year, you think of some of the more obvious things. Oh, I lost my job or this. Those are difficult things. But that stuff didn't happen to me in 2019. What happened to me in 2019 was that I felt still. Does that make sense? In 2019, I started suffering hardcore with anxiety, right, and self-doubt. And it was creeping, you know. I felt it throughout the years, but this year was really bad. It felt like it was on 100. I even want to publicly apologize because I know that I probably was becoming more and more of an introvert this year, right? I've always been a little introverted, a little by myself. I like to be alone, but this year was like, dude, on level 100. Like, I just wanted to be locked away. Even to the point where in November, right, Minister Lee was preaching, and she stopped and, like, literally spoke to me personally and said, I just hear God telling you, you're not forgotten. He's not done with you, right? And that was such a big moment for me. But even then, I was like, I didn't want to hear it. And it wasn't because it was coming from her. It wasn't because it was an on-time word. It was because I was that guarded. Right? The men marched around. You saw that in November. I couldn't join them because I wasn't ready to release the walls yet that you guys were breaking down as you were walking. This is me, and here I am in front of you preaching, right? I'm not better. I'm just saying that even me, I was so heavily guarded, I'm still working on it, but I'm so heavily guarded. I was filled with anxiety. Some of you may know I'm a musician. I make music, and I was refusing to release it. I stepped out on the limb in December and released some music, and I was like, God, this is all on you. But that's part of me breaking those walls down. Amen? By the way, I don't know if you guys know this, but there are, you know what, we're going to get to that. There's things happening in 2020. Amen? And the funny thing is that even back in 2018, July 29th, I preached a word, and I called it Action Plus Faith. Right? Some of you may remember, some of you don't. That's okay. And I read out that very same verse that I just read out to you before we started. Matthew 7. Knock, seek, all those things, right? I read the same exact thing. Yet 2019 for me, I was still. I felt like I was trapped in like quicksand, right? So not just still, but I felt like I was sinking. And the walls were caving in, and I felt like I was, you know, I could see like the quicksand was up to here. I could still breathe a little bit, but it was about to go. That's what I felt like in 2019. Little did I know that in 2019, what God was doing was he was forcing me to heal from certain things, getting me ready for something bigger. I had to look at why and peel the layers of why I was making certain decisions, why I was living a certain way, why I was the way that I was. And it's not over, by the way. I'm still examining those things, but it's almost like God is showing me this is what we were doing in 2019. I was exposing some things because you can't walk the same way, right? And it wasn't that I was sinking and it wasn't that I was still, but I was healing. Anyone who's gone through anything, who's ever gone through an injury, right, Molly, knows that healing is not easy. It takes 1 second to get injured and like long, long time to recover from that injury, right? I've seen some of you guys fall. It's bad. A couple of years ago, maybe you don't know this because I think I hit it pretty well. I actually had back surgery a few years ago. I hit it so well, in fact, I think that I was in pure pain for like 6 months straight. I would still come here every single week. I would still minister. And somehow, this is like a miracle from God. I wouldn't feel pain between the hours of Sunday around 7 a.m. all the way to about 1 p.m. And then I'd start feeling the pain again. So I was able to come here, minister, and then boom, pain all over again, like tears, pain, right? I remember I was here on a Sunday. I think I had surgery like on a Monday or a Tuesday. I was back the next week, spinal surgery. You guys never knew. I was just there like, right? And this is when we were in the school now at that point, so I was playing acoustic, so it was a little easier for me to travel around, right? I couldn't drive for months or anything. I was being driven around. I couldn't do this. Do you know? You don't know. You don't realize, right? What life is like to not be able to go, oh, let me get that real quick. Let me go over here and just, you know, let me wash this part of my body real fast, right? Do you know what life is like to be like, hey, what'd you say? You know? Just looking around like, are you making fun of me? Right? Do you know what it was? I couldn't get up from the bed. I had to call my wife and people, right? I had to call my brother Johnny to come in and look at my wound, and he used to be like, yeah, buddy, that's terrible, man. Anyway, see you later. That looks weird. That's healing kind of weird, right? Yeah, but it's all right, though. Right? I couldn't do this for months. For months, healing was tough. And in the healing process, I had to learn how to move differently. See, in that time, I could no longer get up from the bed like I used to be able to get up from the bed. I had to relearn how to shift and move and move over and come and get off and get up slowly. I had to learn how to sleep differently. Anyone had to relearn how to sleep? That is the worst, right? Like, you don't know how, like, oh, yeah, just sleep on your back. Yeah. Sleep on my back. Let's see how that turns out, right? I'm over here like, trying to turn and spinal, right? I'm here, the Mike Tyson worst of it all, spinal. And my back was killing me, and I had to relearn how to sleep. I had to relearn how to sleep on my side. I had to do all these things differently so that I could now walk the way that I walk again. It took me about the better half of a year, year and a half to heal from that surgery. It was bad. I went back to work way too soon. I had a physical job at that time. I re-injured myself. I had to go to my supervisors and say, I'm going to need to resign or I'm going to have another position. And they demoted me so I could do something else. Okay, that was the truth. They demoted my position and they said, unfortunately, Cruz, because you don't no longer do this kind of work and you're doing this kind of work, we also might have to lower your pay. The first day that I went to go start that job at the lower pay, I was recognized by the new manager that was there and said, oh, Cruz, what are you doing here? Like, oh, yeah, you know, I hurt my back and I can't do it anymore like what we used to do. And he was like, okay, cool, you're a supervisor. And I got promoted day one. The very next week, I got a raise. So I was making more money than I was when I was here. Within a year, that manager was moved to another project, and I took over the project, and I became the manager within a year. I believe there's like 17 people in this church who I hired at some point. Stop asking me for jobs. No, I'm just kidding. I'm not saying that to boast, though, because to be honest with you, I don't necessarily love my job, right? Like, I wish I was doing something else. But God was taking care of me. I had to heal to walk differently, and I had to come to the conclusion that I could no longer do what I used to be able to do so that I could realize, not so that God can, because God was like, I'm trying to put you over here, but you want to be you. You want to provide for your family, right? Like, you want to be a man. Meanwhile, God got this. Gave me more doing less. I asked God, what do you require of me in 2020, Lord? And then Pastor George said, can you preach the first Sunday of it? And I was like, oh, God, okay. So then I had to ask God, what do you require of us in 2020? Last week, Sunday, Pastor Gary was ministering, and I'm still battling with this. And I'm getting, you know, little bits and pieces of what God wants to do in 2020. But then all of a sudden, God gave me clear direction. And he gave me instruction for the congregation and for the leadership of this house. As I started getting this instruction, I went to Pastor George and I said, this sounds kind of crazy, right? Like, this is what God has given me, and I'm kind of afraid to talk about it because it's a little too nutty. You know, I don't want to sound crazy. And he reminded us of 2 Kings. And Pastor George has preached about this a few times, and he's very big on this. In fact, his word for last year, right, he does a word. It was jars. Nobody kind of understood that, but I understood it because of 2 Kings, right? So we're going to read this passage. It's about 400 chapters. No. It's just chapter 4, only 7 verses, okay? So give me your attention for 7 verses. We're going to move fast. Amen? 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 1 through 7. Verse 1. On one day, the widow of a member of the group of prophets came to Elijah and cried out, my husband, who served you, is dead, and you know he feared the Lord. But now a creditor has come threatening to take my two sons as slaves. Very little context. All we know is that this woman, who had a husband at one point, is now passed away, and she's going to Elijah, and the Bible says that she cried out. It was a hard situation. Put yourself in her situation for just 1 second and imagine that your two kids now are going to be taken as slaves because you can't pay debt. Not I'm going to take you to court, none of that stuff. I'm going to enslave your children to pay off the debt. That also tells you that this debt was not small because it was worth not the life of not one but two sons. Okay? Moving on, verse 2. Elijah's so dope for this. What can I do to help you? Okay, because I would have been like, okay, that's not easy. But he said, what can I do to help you? And then he asked her, what do you have in the house? She replied, nothing at all except a flask of oil. A flask of oil. Elijah said, borrow as many empty jars as you can from your friends and neighbors. Then go into your house with your sons and shut the door behind you. Pour olive oil from your flask into the jars, setting each one aside when it is filled. So she did as she was told. Her sons kept bringing jars to her, and she filled one after another. Soon, listen to this, every container was filled to the brim. She yelled, bring me another jar. The sons replied, there aren't any more. And then the olive oil stopped flowing at that very moment. She told Elijah what happened. And then they said, now sell the oil and pay your debts. And you and your sons can live on what's left over. 7 verses, and there were 7 situations that happened here. Can I break them down for you really quickly? Number 1, acknowledgement of need. You just heard me tell you the story how I had back surgery, came here every week, you never even noticed. I never told anyone how much pain I was in, how much of a struggle that was for an entire year, right? There's going to be some things in 2020 now that we have to acknowledge that we need help. Not just because we actually need help, but because we have to come to the place of submission and saying, God, I need you to take over the situation. Also in that thing, and this was for me personally, and maybe this is for some of you in here, I'm not saying that people are trustworthy because we know that only God is the trustworthy and people will hurt you, but there are going to be some people that we have to talk to in 2020. And say, you know what, I'm at the end of my rope. On the flip side, when they come to you, we're going to have to be like Elijah and say, what do you need? It's not easy. but that's family. Situation number two, willingness to ask. If she wasn't willing to ask, she would have never saw this miracle. If she wasn't willing to lay down her pride and say, Elijah, I look crazy right now, but I have nothing else. Number three, she listened. So many of us, when we're in the thick of it, man, we're not willing to listen. Some of our prayers sound like one-way prayers, right? We don't want to hear God. God, I need. And God is like, wait, hold on. Shh, I got instruction for you. And as crazy as that instruction was, because I'm sorry, maybe you're holier than me, but if somebody told me, I want you to go and collect all the jars, I'm like, okay, thanks, Elijah. That makes sense. I'm just going to knock on every people's door. Can I have your precious material? Because we're living in a time where everything is precious, where people don't just get, oh, wait a minute, I got 14 jars over here. I made them by scratch. No, I earned this. This was hard to get. I had to make this with material that was not free. I sacrificed for these jars, and you want to borrow my jar? Neighbor, friend? Okay. Number four, she shut the door. In 2020, God wants to do something in your life, but there's some people and there's some things that can't come with you. So she did something very specific. She took who she was supposed to bring in. She said, my two sons, and then she shut the door because what is going to take place here, they can't see. The junk that I was going to bring in can't be here while I do this. Number five, she did what she was told. That sounds like I'm saying something very machismo here, but what I'm saying is that she listened and she went and did. She did the action. She went and knocked on doors and borrowed jars like a crazy person and filled them with this much oil and filled every jar. Number six, God filled every jar. Get this, if you don't get anything else, not one time in the scripture does it say how many jars she was told to collect. That means if she had just gotten one, God would have filled one and the oil would have stopped. But if she had gotten 100. But because she listened and she didn't stop, she got every jar she could. Which leads me to number seven. She got so much oil out of that. Listen to what the Bible says, that she was instructed that she could now pay back her debt from selling the oil and live off the rest. And not just her, by the way. It says her two sons. In today's standards, that's like millionaire status. I won the lotto. But even in this scripture, listen up, people. This is God. Listen up. Though God blessed that, he didn't give her a lotto ticket. There was still action that needed to happen. Now I got to go sell this oil. Now I got to keep going and actually go get this money. I got to go get the jars. I got to go in and shut the door and shut people out. I got to convince my children to keep giving me jars and let the kids see. The kids needed to see that. Because what she was doing was blessing their lives. FYI, parents, and this is for me, our kids are watching. If we teach them worry, if we teach them anxiety, that's what they'll grow up to be, perfecting all of our sins. But if we teach them that sometimes you got to shut that door and trust in God. Do you know what you're creating? If she only got one jar, maybe that's all she would have gotten out of it. And I don't know if she would have been able to pay her debts because it was massive if they were willing to take her kids. But because she believed. And the beautiful part about this scripture too is that Elijah never told her the end result. He never said, you're going to get oil, you're going to fill the jars, and then you're going to sell it and have enough money to pay your debt. All he told her was, go get the jars and fill the oil and fill them with oil. She had no idea what he was talking about. And then what? I don't know. It's at the end that she goes back and said, God filled all these jars. He said, now go pay off your debt. Instruction without even the end result in front of her. Still, she did what God commanded her to do. In this season of blessing, God is going to call you to do some things because God is not a genie. You don't rub the lamp. What do you need? What do you need, right? That's an Aladdin reference. The cartoon, not the movie. God is not a genie. There's always a required action. We see it all through Scripture. Moses, I want you to go free the slaves. God, oh, okay. But then the Bible says Moses did as he was commanded. Hey, Noah, I want you to build this ark. Okay, that's crazy. But then the Bible says Noah did as he was commanded. Hey, Abraham, this is a crazy one. Hey, Abraham, I want you to go sacrifice your son. My son? But then the Bible says that Abraham did as he was commanded. Thank God he didn't have to do it. But he did. He was willing to do what God commanded. In 2020, there's a blessing that's coming. But there's going to be some things that you're going to have to do as God commanded. And then there are some things that are out of your control. You see, all that she could do was go collect the jar. She couldn't make more oil. She had to just depend on God to fill every jar. Today, as I said before, God gave me specific instruction, and I want to issue you a challenge because I believe that this instruction is very important. In my life, right, I've been doing this for years now, and it always amazes me how God provides. It doesn't necessarily happen in New Year's, but, you know, for like the new year, I've just been doing this. Every time I go, I hit a hard ceiling. I go on my computer. I save them in my drafts because I've been doing this for so long. It was like before you had notes on your phone, right? So I go in my drafts, and I write down everything that I'm believing God for. And every time I did it, it was in the season where I was like really bad. So I'm like, okay, I lost my job. I'm this, I'm that. God, I'm believing for a new job. I'm believing for this. I'm believing for that. And every time I rewinded back, or I would look back at these things, God fulfilled it. Every single one. Every single one. So God told me, as Pastor Gary was ministering last week, God told me 20. And I said, okay, yeah, the year 2020. Got it. Now, I don't want to be corny, God, you know. But then he said, no, 20. Believe for 20. So every time I did this, I would write maybe 3-4 things down, and I think that's a lot. That's a lot to ask for because some of these things are massive. But God said, no, believe for 20. So I'm going to challenge each and every one of you. You're not going to do it today because it took me hours. I wrote my list. It took me hours to come up with this list. 20 things that you're believing God for in the year 2020. This is, I know it feels good, but I'm telling you right now, don't sell it short. What God is calling for is that for you to believe in the things that he already has for you. There's some things that you need to write on that list that you think are impossible. We sang this morning, impossible things, right? But we're not walking in it. God says, no, put it. And God told me to say it because I see it prophetically. There's homes in 2020 for you. There's healing in 2020 for you. I heard very specifically cleanliness, meaning like very strategically towards drug abuse and alcohol abuse. If there's something that there's somebody struggling in here with this year, it's over. There are some things in my life that I'm putting in that I've already put in that list. I put a lot of very personal things and things that I have really that I think are impossible. And God said, cool, bring me all the jars. Because you could bring me one, I'll fill it. But if you bring me every one, I'm gonna fill it. The oil won't run out until you stop with the jars. This season, there's a blessing, not just for you as individuals, but for this congregation, for this church. This is for the leadership team. I heard God said that in 2021, by the time this year is over, this congregation is going to triple in size. And I heard God say this, leadership team, start getting ready because you're going to have to make some decisions. Some people are going to have to come on full time. Some people are going to have to start. We're going to have to start paying people because we're going to have to staff in this church. This is not for boasting, by the way. This is just saying that God has chosen this church, this congregation, to be a central hub, to be a place of healing, a place of restoration, that people who are coming in, just as Pastor Jasmine, right? You guys heard what she said? That people are going to come here looking like rejects. Rejects. But you're going to come out. You're going to come out differently. There's a calling upon this house, upon this congregation. There's a reason why this building looks the way it does, feels the way it does. There's a reason why 2019 was the way that it was, because it's a preparation for 2020. So I'm believing God for those things. So I'm going to put this demand on all of you. This is homework that you have an entire year basically to fill, but I do it fast, right? I did my list already. 20 things that you think are impossible, but God got it. And God's already speaking to you. Relationship restorations. Maybe some of you want to connect more with your children. God got it. God got it. You're believing in new jobs and more finances. God got it. God got it. Nothing is impossible in this new season. I want to read you one more thing, and I'm going to reread you Matthew 7:7 again. It's for me just as much as it is for you. And I want you to realize something. It says, ask, which is an action, and it will be given to you, which is the blessing. Right? It says, seek, and you will find. Seek the action, find the blessing. Knock the action, and the door will be open to you. That's the blessing. There's some things that, yes, you can't control, but we're going to believe for it in 2020. And just to prove to you that we're not alone in this, I already spoke to to your pastors, and I'm going to ask Pastor George to come up right now. I've asked Pastor George, and I've given him this challenge, and he looked at me and he went, whoa. But then immediately, as he was telling me, God already gave it to him. So I wanted him to just come up and just give you guys, share some of his list and what he's believing for in 2020. Amen.
This is my favorite passage in all of Scripture. And it's amazing how God has such 2020 vision, because we were, and it's not to be corny, but it's so true. God has such 2020 vision that we were doing the book of James at the end of the year, which is all about what? Stepping out in faith, believing. And James tells us faith without works is dead. Faith without works is dead. And then we start 2020 talking about gather all the empty jars. How many should I gather, God? I didn't tell you. I just said, go to your neighbors and get the jars. And then lock yourself in. And I won't repeat the whole message, but you get it. There was no number. The limit, who limits it? You, we limit it. The limit of what God wants to do is the limit that we put on. Amen? We should be a little bit more excited. I don't know. There should be oil dripping right now just from okay, so he asked me about me. Okay, well, this is what I've been getting so much pressure from so many of you. You better write your book. You got to write your book. When are you going to write your book? When are you going to write a book? And it's like I bump into strangers and, hey, you got a book yet? I'm like, you don't even know me, bro. It's like from everywhere. So fun. So I was talking to my wife before this message. And she said, well, you know what? You have to take action. I'm like, yeah, no joke. Okay, I get it. You know, like, I know that. But you have to take action. And so she said, how about if you take your lunch break, take your laptop and lock yourself in a Starbucks for your lunch break every day and just write? I said, man, that's
That's only a little bit brilliant. So you know what? I started. Amen? I started. Now, I don't know. My first book, I've been telling you guys this for 14 years. As soon as I get to sermon number 365, I'm going to put a daily devotional, so make each sermon a devotional for, I don't know who wants to read a devotional from some Cuban little pastor in the Bronx, but we're going to put it out. Amen. So I started it and I'm working on it. And so that's one thing I'm believing God, that God will get me through to do it. Again, it takes action, not just faith. There's some of these things that take, they require you to step, right? It's a different thing coming out on Wednesday, coming out on Sunday, and just praying, God, I need you to make me a better man. And not doing anything and still doing the same things. Amen. It takes action. The second one I'm going to give you, the last one, and this is one totally out of my hands. I'm believing that God's going to pay off the mortgage in this building. Now, if you have a mortgage, you understand what that's like, but I doubt your mortgage is $1.8 million. Unless y'all are living large, somebody in here. Right? But we pay 11 grand every month in a mortgage. If we didn't have to pay $11,000 a month in mortgage, we had people on staff. Amen? And just so if you guys are visiting, just so you know, even your senior pastor's not on staff. I work a full-time job, okay? Just to make things clear. I'm believing, amen. So I'm believing this year God can do it. It's just all it is. When you look in the scheme of things with God, and Gary, you could come up. When you look at the scheme of things with God, all that mortgage is one jar. It's one jar. One jar. What if I only brought that one jar this year? Kind of a big deal in our lives. But to God, it's one jar. Do you think God's going to say, "Woo, that was a big hit"? $1 million. Oh, I'm almost out of oil, God's going to say. I don't know if I can bless anybody else the rest of this year. No, to him, it's one jar. It's like a little jar. I'm believing God can fill that jar this year. Amen. Gary has some. Come on, G.
I have a testimony that's directly in line with the sermon that you just heard, because most of you know that I'm getting married in a few months, and so I needed to move, and I had this wrong mindset. I was telling God, I hope that the place that I move to can be maybe half as nice as where I'm living now, where there's a pool in the summer and I have a terrace and there's plenty of parking. I said, I know I'll never get a pool and maybe I'll have to park somewhere else, but maybe it'll be decent. And the Lord rebuked me. He said, you be preaching all this stuff about breakthrough and giving prophetic words that God's doing a great thing and a new thing, and now you're willing to settle for less. Well, last week I signed a contract on a condo that costs less than the one I own now, and it has three pools, an indoor pool, all the parking that I want, and for the first time in my life, I have central air conditioning, which I want to, that's what I want in my whole life. And God has given me that message, not only for me, but for the new year. God told me to go, just like the message you just heard, that it's time to expect. It's not time to settle or compromise or go backwards. He said, tell my people, don't go back to that old hurtful relationship because you think there's nothing better. It's not time to drop out of school. It's not time to go back to a profession that you left because you hated, because I guess I'll never find anything better. God is saying it's time to expect increase. It's time to double and triple and move forward. So I'm going to ask everyone to stand right now. Because you have to determine in your own heart. You see, if I would have kept that attitude of God never have anything, I'm always going to go back to the same old thing. It looks like things are getting better, and now it's going to all fall apart. I refuse to think that way anymore. And I'm challenging you, every one of you, just like the woman with the jars of oil. I'm going to keep believing God. Here's another jar. Here's more. So I'm going to ask you right now, as we start this new year, how many of you are willing to believe with me that you're believing that this is the year? This is the year God is going to bring those things that I've been waiting, the things I've been praying for. Some of you, God is going to give you that spouse you've been waiting for in this year. Some of you are going to get the job. You're going to step into the profession that you've always wanted. Some of you, you're going to start that business. But it starts with believing God. He doesn't want you to stay stuck. I break that mindset off you right now in Jesus' name. In every way where you believe that. Well, not for somebody like me. No, not people like us. Not for someone like us. Not our family. Not where we come from. Maybe that's for you, but not for us. That's a lie from hell. For every single one of you, this can be the greatest year in your life. But you got to take God at his word. You're saying, I'm stepping out. I'm not settling anymore. I'm not going to stay one more day. Not one more day in that same old mess. It's time to believe. So I'm going to ask Jason to come back. And he's going to pray over you right now. He's going to release the blessings of this new year. Because these are the people of God right now. They raise their hand. They're saying, I'm believing. I'm responding to your message. So let's just seal it right now in Jesus' name.
Amen. So we're standing with you. And we're believing with you just as you're standing with us. So God, with every hand raised right now, Father. Lord, we believe. Not in ourselves. We don't believe in our circumstances. We don't believe in our bank accounts. We don't believe in our and what can be provided through external and just worldly things. Father God, we believe in you. Right now, I even see that there's things that are stirring up inside of you. Things that you're saying, well, I'm going to put that on the list then. Because you're hearing the testimonies. God saying, go ahead. There's some things in here right now, and I believe it prophetically, that are already, you put on the list, and they're already scratched off. God already did it. Day 5. So replace it. Replace it. Okay, that's done. Add another one. Give me another jar. Go get another jar. Right now, spiritually, go get another jar. Keep getting that jar in Jesus' name. Lord, we just pray right now, Father God. That not for you to do it because it's done, but for us to believe it, Father. for us to even get a glimpse of understanding, Father, of what you're doing in our lives, Lord Jesus. Lord, we pray right now, Lord Jesus, that not one person leaves here even with an ounce of doubt of what you're capable of right now in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray right now that today we mark the day of a spiritual awakening, of a spiritual movement, of spiritual miracles right now, Father God. Today was the day that you changed and wrecked our lives in the name of Jesus, Lord. Lord, we believe in your miracles. We believe that you're still a God of miracles, that you're not finished, Lord Jesus. We believe that you have called us to be right where we are at this very moment, receiving it. And there's somebody in here who was ready to give up, huh? There's somebody who was ready to give up, but God said, I got you. Give me another jar. I got you. Get me another jar. I got you. I'm not done with you yet. Right now, and I pray that I seal this with the blood of Jesus. Lord, we just pray for this house right now, Father God. We believe that this house is going to be a central station, Father, for healing. And we pray for the Bronx, Father, right now, Lord Jesus. We pray for New York City right now, Lord, Father God. We know exactly what the world is going through right now. We know exactly what's going on. But it won't wreck us. It won't affect our faith. It won't stop us from believing in who you are. And it won't stop us from healing every single one of the people who come in here to receive your blessing. And we pray, Father God, that we don't get big heads, that we don't take it too serious, that we think that we all that we're planet shakers, that we're, you know, we're this, we're that. We think that we're, no. God, you're in control, you're the center, and as we grow, it's because of you, and we'll trust in you every step of the way, just like we did 14 years ago, and we'll continue to do it today in the name of Jesus. And if you don't believe, right now, I pray, God, that you start wrecking us. I hope you guys are okay with this prayer, but I'm going to pray it anyway. I pray that you lose sleep. I pray that God won't even let you sleep until you finish this list. I pray that tonight you toss and turn until you get back up and you get and take that piece of paper and that pen and you write down exactly what God is calling you to be blessed for in 2020. Right now, in the name of Jesus. This is miracle season, and we believe you, God. We believe your word that you're not done. You raise people from the dead. You fill jars with nothing. You complete the incomplete. You give sight to the blind. And so this is just one jar. It's nothing for you, God. And we thank you in advance for what you're doing right now. And as we worship right now, Father God, I pray that even then, there still be a strong anointing that will continue to just wreck us, Father God. Remind us over and over and over and over and over again that you're fully capable. Nothing is too big and nothing is too small. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Father God, for 2020. Thank you, Father God, because this, it's already complete. It's already done. In Jesus' name, we thank you right now, Father God.
Hey, thank you for watching. I hope you were blessed. If you were encouraged, go ahead and tell somebody, subscribe to our site. And if you want to just support the ministry, you go ahead and click on the Give Now button. You can see plenty of other messages on our website. Thank you for coming by. Be blessed. Amen.